and welcome to worship with us here this morning at Woodmont. We are so glad that you are joining us, whether online or in person. Thank you for being here with us this morning. I want to first encourage you to download the Woodmont Baptist Church app in the app or Google Play Store. This is where you can fill out our Connect card, send us a prayer request, or you can even join the church or make a decision in that way today through the app on the Connect portion. Kids, I want to show you quickly what's in your worship pack today. You've got some candy and some stickers and worship notes, but you also have a cool piece of paper, and it says one of our verses we're going to study today, and it says, even God's weakness is stronger than, and then I want you to put all these superheroes somewhere underneath that, because even God's weakness is stronger than the strongest human strength. So remember that today, and we're glad you're here.
Good morning. We are so glad you're here with us, and we're thankful for each of you and thankful for you being here. We do just want to take time and think about that God's weakness is stronger than any of our strength. And any of those superheroes, man, those children's packets look fun, don't they? How many of you would like a children's packet this morning, right? You know, that'd be something good to do during the sermon when that preacher just keeps going and going, you know. That'd be fun to have some stickers. We hope that in your life, you stick to the Lord, and that you see His strength and His power, and that you draw close to Him in these moments of confusion and weakness. And so we're going to pray for you, pray for us as a church to make wise decisions, and pray for our nation as well. Let's pray. God, we love you. Father, we thank you for your goodness, your grace, your strength, your wisdom. Father, we thank you, Lord, that so many people, even though they see us gathering together, they see us worshiping the cross of Jesus, and they may look at it as if it's foolishness, as if the message has lost its power, as if the message has lost its relevance. But God, we know, Father, that the word is still true. And so, Father, we stand on that strong foundation, and we ask you, Lord, to build us up, Father, for your glory and your purposes. And Father, we ask you, Lord, that your church would make decisions based on the most God-glorifying things we can do. And Father, we pray you would lead us and help us to reach people for your namesake. Father, we ask you, Lord, to do mighty and marvelous things in your way, in your timing, and in your power. And Father, we pray, God, that we would take this time in the season of the uncomfortable, in the season of the unknown, Father, that we would focus our eyes on you, that you are essential to us. And Father, we love you. We thank you for these that are gathered here this morning. We thank you for those that are watching from home, Father, or watching as they travel, or watching through online broadcast. Father, we pray for them. We ask you to bless every home that's represented. We ask you, Lord, to calm nerves and anxieties within us, Father, and help us to get back in our trust and our rest in the solid foundation of Jesus Christ and Him alone. Father, we pray, Lord, that you would continue to show us from your word, Father, a faithful response to the times like these. And God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the Holy Spirit within us to guide us and lead us. And Father, we thank you for the power of the message of the cross. And Father, we ask you to bless our time together today in your name. Amen. Would you stand together as we worship the Lord?
Good morning, church. It's good to see you all here in your Sunday best mask. Your Sunday go-to meeting mask. This crowd can relate to this. About 20 years ago, there was a movie that came out called City Slickers, and it's making a renewal. But it's a movie about three men that were going through a midlife crisis. So as a result, they decided to go on to a dude ranch and participate in a cattle drive. And along the way, in their search for clarity, they meet this old cowboy named Curly, Jack Palance, and like I say, in the quest for clarity, Joe tells one of the cowboys, said, "The secret of life. You want to know the secret of life? It's that one thing. That one thing." And the other guy looks at him and says, "You know, waiting. Well, what is it?" He said, "That one thing. What's that one thing?" He said, "You got to find that for yourself." The writer of Psalm 27 knew that one thing, said, "This one thing I desire of the Lord. The thing that I desire most is to seek the Lord all the days of my life and to dwell in his temple. This one thing to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord. That's cool. This morning, we're going to gaze upon the Lord, all right? It may be, you may be like Moses, you want to see his face to face, but you only get to see his hand. You may be like Isaiah, who sees the Lord high and lifted up in his temple. You may want to behold the Lamb, the Christ hanging on the cross for you, buying your salvation. Your vision of the Lord may be the resurrected Lord there at the temple, or it may be even the Lord coming in glorious clouds. What's your vision of the Lord this morning? Let's pray as we worship. Father, open our eyes and our hearts to see you. Lord, may you become this one thing in our lives today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Tremble.
Well, that was good right there, wasn't it? Woo! Sometimes we get to worship and I start singing so loud my voice not ready to preach when I get up here. You know what I'm talking about? I might have to pull one of you out of the crowd and ask you to preach this morning. Did you come ready? Anybody else got a sermon this morning? That's dangerous, isn't it? Ooh, man. About to get ourselves in trouble. And people online really tuning in now, aren't they? Seeing who's going to step up. We're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 1. So we are thankful for you. I'm thankful that you're here this morning. I did a wedding yesterday, and I was outside, and you know it was a little bit hot out there yesterday, and I had a sermon and a half, about an hour and a half long for that sermon. You know, I mean, it's just a really good day, and I'm just kidding. It was only about 20 minutes, but and before that happened, before the service took place, we were standing around talking. I was talking to one of the videographers, and we were talking about their summer and their spring and how all these events got canceled and everything like that and how that made an impact on them. But he had a pair of khaki shorts on, and he was lamenting the fact that he was not wearing cargo shorts because he could have had all those pockets, you know, to put in the extra battery pack or the extra microphone or the extra cable that he needed. And he said, man, I used to make fun of people that wore cargo shorts and all those pockets and all those things on them, you know. And he said, and now here I am. I need them. I realized that's pretty useful. And I said, yeah, I said, the same's true for me. I used to make fun of people that wear a suit outside in August in Alabama. But here I am, you know. And I think that sometimes, you know, we have these things in our life that we operate by the world's wisdom, or we make our plans, but the Lord redirects our steps or directs our steps in the path that He would want us to go. And He leads us, and He's faithful to do that. But it may look like foolishness to everyone else, but God is good, isn't He? And the word, the truth of His word stands firm. And so we got to hold to it. And the temptation for us right now is that so many people are hurting and frustrated and confused maybe, and you're just tired. And so I pray that today this will be an encouraging word for you, that we stand firm on the foundation of Jesus Christ and His cross and that alone. And we are actually at an advantage compared to everybody else, because we rest in the Lord Jesus and His sovereignty. And we rest in the fact that He's in control and everybody else trying to figure everything out. And we know what happens, right? And so we can rest in that, knowing that the Lord is leading. He's in control. Things that He said are going to come to pass are coming to pass. Like in Luke 21, when He says there's going to be pandemics or epidemics around the world. Well, once again, the Bible's true, isn't it? So I tell you what, let's pray together. God, we love You. Father, we thank You for Your word and for the power of it. And Father, we thank You, Lord, that it's true. And God, it just proves itself over and over and over again, Lord, to be You and be Your word. And so, Father, we are thankful today that You are the way, You are the truth, and You are the life. God, there is no other name by which men are saved other than Jesus Christ. God, in the worldly wisdom, we've come up with a lot of ways that we think we can make people better. We can make communities better, nations better. But God, apart from You, and apart from You doing a heart transplant and making us a new creation, Lord, there is no hope. And our best efforts will surely fail and prove that there's a futility of the world's wisdom. So God, we pray, Lord, that You would guide us and lead us now in Your word and for Your truth, for Your glory and Your purposes. And God, You would use us in all ways. In Your name, amen. So we're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 20 through 25. And we're going to look in this as Paul begins to point out another area where the church was divided and where the church was struggling. You remember that they were already divided on who they were following. Some people had followed Paul, some followed Cephas, some followed Apollos. And then some said they followed Jesus, and we talked about that last week. But we now get into the point where some people are following the world's wisdom, and Paul has to take them back to the wisdom of the cross and the wisdom of the Lord. So here we go, verse 20, it says this, "Where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know Him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. Jews demand a sign, and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than human wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than human strength. So this becomes the foundation of our unity, is we're able to discern the futility of the world's wisdom and the fruition of God's plan. And so we all gather around together in the body of Christ, centered on the plan of God and the purposes of God, and knowing and trusting that He is working all things for our good and for His glory, that He is in control, that He didn't wake up today and think, oh no, what am I going to do? But instead, that He is orchestrating all things, guiding them and leading them so that it will point to His return and our victory for all eternity. And so the first thing we see is the futility of worldly wisdom. And Paul starts out by saying, where is the wise person? Where's the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? And what he's doing in this is he's quoting from Isaiah. Isaiah is often referred to as the gospel in the Old Testament because there's so many prophecies and encounters about Jesus in that book that it becomes, and it reads like the story of Christ when you read through it. But in Isaiah 19 and 12 through 15 is the verses. Isaiah writes and he says, where then are your wise men? You hear the similarity that Paul, he knows, he knew that Old Testament text. He was so familiar with the works. So he uses this same language. Where then are your wise men? Let them tell you and reveal what the Lord of armies has planned against Egypt. The princes of Zoan have been fools. The princes of Memphis are deceived. Her tribal chieftains have led Egypt astray. In verse 14 it says, the Lord has mixed within her a spirit of confusion. The leaders have made Egypt stagger in all she does, as a drunkard staggers in his vomit. No head or tail, palm or reed will be able to do anything for Egypt. Does that prophecy sound a little bit familiar and a little bit too comfortable, doesn't it? Sounds a little bit too familiar for us in our current times. That Egypt had built itself up on so much pride, so many things to point to as the greatness of their own people and the greatness of their own leaders and all this kind of stuff. And so Isaiah comes to Egypt and he says, well, where is your wise people? Why don't you allow the wise men of this day and of your country to tell you what God is going to do? And he's pointing out to them in an ironic way. He's saying, you don't have any wisdom because you're not connected with the Lord. And this is the great danger of leadership when we disconnect from the Lord, either in the church or in government places where God appoints leaders, is that the Lord mixes in there, within her, a spirit of confusion. There's no clarity because there's no joint and united worldview. There's no foundation of truth, and they've wiped that out. And so suddenly this nation, Egypt, is staggering in all it does. It's staggering as if a drunk. And then if you turn over to Isaiah 33, Isaiah begins to address the Assyrians. And look what he says here in Isaiah 33. It says, your mind will recall the terror you experienced when you will ask yourselves, where is the scribe? Where is the one who weighs the money? Where is the one who counts the towers? And so what they're asking is, where's the accountant? Where's the one who is the scribe? And you know this, it says, you will recall the terror you experienced. Sometimes the Lord in His gracious discipline, and it's gracious, by the way, that He is leading us and calling us out from being self-sufficient. He's calling us out from putting all of our hope in man. And what we see over and over again through generation to generation throughout history is that we see great movements of God that come out of great terrors of God, or the gracious discipline that God leads in nations and all of this. And so Paul points out to the Corinthians, he says this, where is the wise person? Where is the teacher of the law? Where is the philosopher of this age? And these are the three areas that the people of Corinth had built themselves in. They thought they were so wise according to the world standard. They thought they were great philosophers of their day, and that they had all this new truth that nobody had ever considered before. They had all these new foundational philosophies that nobody had ever pondered the depths to which they were pondering. And they thought that they were great teachers of the laws that nobody else knew, that they discovered these deep truths. But here's what Paul says. He says this. He says, for since the wisdom of God, the world through its wisdom did not know Him, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached. And that leads us to the foolishness of faithful preaching. And he goes on to explain it like this. He says, Jews demand signs And Greeks demand wisdom. Can I tell you something that's dividing the church right now? And this is current day. This is not just in Paul's day. It is in today's world where people will either demand signs or great intellectual discourses. Our churches are built around these two philosophies of ministry, where either they come and they expect, and maybe you fall into one of these categories, you come and you expect to see a great sign. You expect to see, oh, I just want to see God do something great. I want to see Him do something marvelous. Can I tell you something marvelous that God has done? He's allowed us to be here. He saved our life through the power of the gospel in Jesus. He's turned our direction and transformed our hearts. He has done already great and incredible things. And He may be doing incredible things in the small things. Maybe the great and incredible thing in your life is that this week you read the Word every day. Well, for some of you, that'd be a big miracle. But it's necessary. It's the foundation of a relationship with Him, that He would do the great and the powerful in what seems to be the ordinary. But yet these Jewish people, they were like critics that critique the message, and we still have them today, right? That they come looking for a sign. They want to see the sensational. And in Matthew 12, 38 through 39, it says this: "Then some of the experts in the law, along with some of the Pharisees, answered him, 'Teacher, we want to see a sign from you.' But he answered them, 'An evil and adulterous generation asked for a sign, but no sign will be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah.'" And we got to explain this out a little bit. So the Jewish people, and by the time Matthew 12 gets here, Jesus has done all kinds of signs. He's done all kinds of wonders. But here's the problem of this worldview, is that it's never enough. When you become addicted to the sensational, you want more sensational stuff, don't you? This is why there have been some ministries in the past where sensational things happen. And then you know what the pressure is the next week? Oh, we got to get more sensational. We got to get the crowd coming back. Because what is the crowd that's going to come back the next week? Oh, they're looking for more sensational things to happen. And this leads to a false religion, false theology, false opportunities of what we see. For example, maybe you're familiar with teachers like Benny Hinn and those that start to throw people around, throw them on the ground, cast out demons, all that kind of stuff. And the crowds come to watch the show. What's interesting is in Jesus' time, he did these great miracles, for example, in Matthew 6, in other parts of the Word, John chapter 6, he feeds the 5,000. And he tells them, he says, "I am the bread of life." And what happens over time is that those people want to see the great signs. They want to see the great wonders. And so they're all following. Think about that, 5,000. And that's not even counting the women and the children. And then what happens? He turns to them and says this: "If you follow me, you must eat of my body and drink of my blood." And he's teaching them the new covenant. And what happens? The crowd disperses because they can't handle the teaching that the sign was pointing to. They can't handle the fellowship and the discipleship. And that's the reason the sign was there, is to show him he had all authority and all power on heaven and earth is given to him. And so then he commands us to go and make disciples because of that truth, right? In John chapter 2, verse 18, it says, "So then the Jewish leaders responded, 'What sign can you show us since you are doing these things?'" And remember, he said, it's an adulterous and wayward generation that asked for this. No sign will be given to you except the sign of Jonah. Well, what was the sign of Jonah? You remember that? Oh, he was sent to preach, right? But he didn't preach. He got swallowed by a great fish, and then the great fish spit him out 3 days later, and then he preached. And there was great grace poured out on the city of Nineveh because of their repentance. What's the sign of Jonah for us is that Jesus came preaching, completely obedient, was buried in the grave for 3 days, came out preaching the power and the grace of the resurrection. It's the sign that we're desperate for. It's where we find the power of Jesus. It's why we have to hold to the truth of Scripture. And so if you're here today and you're demanding a sign, "Oh, Chad, oh, preacher, I want to see something. I want to see God do something." We could easily go down the road where we became more sensational, more sensational, more sensational. But what would come out of that is just a desire for the sensational and not a desire for the Savior. A desire for the show and not a desire for sanctification. A desire for great entertainment, but not great theology. Not great discipleship. Not great relationship with the Lord Jesus. And then what else comes out of that is this two-tier kind of Christianity where some people have these great and powerful display of spiritual gifts, and other people we minimize because they don't have the sensational side. They don't see the sensational gifts. And so we look down on them as if they don't have anything, and it creates the same problem that was happening in the church at Corinth. But then there's another side that Paul points to, and he says the Greeks look for wisdom. See, they wanted an intellectual discourse on the philosophy of Christianity, the philosophy of religion and how Jesus did all this. And so they were demanding wisdom, and there may be some of you here today doing that same thing, right? Maybe you want your pastor to do a great intellectual discourse on the text here in 1 Corinthians. Maybe you want some deep theological truth that you never considered out of this passage. And unless you get that, then you'll say, that was an average sermon at best, right? I know none of you all think that, but sometimes, you know, people out of state, they're watching online, they may think that about me, right? And so they think, who is this high-tech hillbilly that doesn't know the great theologians, right? All this kind of stuff. And so what can happen is that we start to demand this intellectual discourse that goes on and talk over people's heads and things like that. And Jesus is calling us back to the simple message of the cross, back to the simple message of the hope of the gospel and the power of Jesus. And so he calls us to this faithful preaching of Jesus. But Paul was associated with this. For example, in Acts 17, in verse 23, he shows up at the Areopagus there in Mars Hill. And he says this, he says, "For as I went around and observed closely your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. Therefore, what you worship without knowing it, this I proclaim to you." Even their wisdom and all their wisdom, they had to make room for a God they may not know. Agnosticism. Well, we can't know if there's a God or not. The Greek response to agnosticism was, we have all these gods, and just in case we forgot one that we didn't know, we're going to make another one. And this is the one to the unknown, to what can't be known, what can't we haven't discovered yet, right? And so he says, I walked around and I saw this to an unknown God, and therefore what you worship without knowing it, this I proclaim to you, the God who made the world and everything in it, who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by human hands. I want you to hear the theology of that people of that day. Their wisdom depended on humanity. It was secular humanism. It was based on the strength of the human. It was based on the strength and the power and the wisdom from within. And so you see this, I don't know if you're familiar with Francis Schaeffer, but Francis Schaeffer in his books, he's really great at pointing out the art of a day. And he'll study a time period's art to reflect and show how it reflects the worldview of that day. For example, the statue of David. He points out that it has such large hands. And the hope of that people during that time, during the Renaissance, was in their hands. Oh, we can create all kinds of things. We have the power and the wisdom to know more than what we're rediscovering the strength and the power of man. And so the sculptor reflects that in how big he makes the hands of David. They're abnormally sized. And this is the same thing that's happening here in Greek. Listen to this. The God who made the world and everything in it, who is Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by human hands. He's not contained by what your hands can do, by your own strength. Nor is he served by human hands, as if he needed anything, because he himself gives life and breath and everything to everyone. There's a popular movement right now that God is dependent on us. This is what some of the churches today are building, churches and ministries around the idea that you're the center of it, that you're the center of everything they do. We got to do all that we can to build a crowd, to bring you in, because God is desperate for you to be a part of this. Can we remind you that what Acts 17 says is so important? God is self-sufficient. He doesn't need any of us. But instead, out of his grace and his love for us, he invites us. He calls us. He engages us to be a part of his mission and a part of his purposes. And that's the power of the gospel. Then to go on at verse 26 of Acts 17, it says, "From one man he made every nation of the human race to inhabit the entire earth, determining their set times and the fixed limits of the places where they would live, so that they would search for God," listen to this, "and perhaps grope around for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us." The 2 Corinthians says that we are blinded by the world. right? We're blinded by sin and death, and we're desperate to have those blinders taken off of us, and that's what happens in the grace, right? It's the amazing grace. You remember that song? And it says, I once was blind, but now I see, right? And you see this picture here. It says that people, as Paul describes it, they're groping around to find the Lord, and when they find him, it says, though he is not far from each one of us, that the good news of the gospel is that God is not just transcendent, but he came and lived and walked around us. It says that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That he was tempted in every way, so that we know that we have a high priest who has sympathy when we are tempted. But he's also faithful in every temptation to provide a way out. So we know that we have a faithful Father protecting us. For in him we live and move about and exist, as even some of your own poets have said, for we too are his offspring. So since we are God's offspring, we should not think the deity is like gold or silver or stone or an image made by human skill and imagination. You know, there are worldviews that are impacting our world today. And just like Francis Schaeffer would point out, our art puts those on display for us. A very interesting movie came out. I'm not recommending it, but I'm just going to use it as an illustration to show you some of the ways that the worldview is interacting with us today. Last year, there was a movie released. It was called The Joker. It kind of gave you, you all know The Joker, right? The enemy of Batman and all this kind of stuff. And it kind of gave us a look at his life before he became the demented enemy of Batman, right? And what happens is that he's this struggling comedian, right? He's a struggling comedian, and he gets all discouraged and kind of off track. He develops this psychological issue where he laughs at inappropriate issues and issues and things that he sees happening that are this really, really dark sense of humor. And it goes farther and farther and farther and darker, 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 until the point that he becomes like this celebrity for the rioters that are happening in Gotham. And what are they rioting about? Well, they're writing about those that have money. And they're beginning to get resentful of those that are wealthy and successful. And they're not just mad and angry about that, but they're angry that there seems to be no care or concern for those that don't have those resources. So he becomes this big celebrity, and he becomes the symbol of everything that they're putting their hope in. And many people mimic his style and his approach. And it's very interesting because the author of, in this article from Philosophy Today, he does something interesting with the review of this movie. And he says this, I think of the Christian idea that the greatest are those who serve, they and not the strong being pointed out as having the first place in God's regard. So contempt towards the lowly in the movie is not merely a symptom of indifference, but satanic arrogance. Now, this is an atheist perspective on this movie, and what he's pointing to is that when you remove Christianity and you remove the influence of Christianity, that we, as those with resources, should take care of those that do not have those resources, he's saying suddenly there's a satanic influence on that. That suddenly we begin to separate ourselves and we begin to laugh at the poor. We begin to laugh at their struggles and disconnect ourselves completely from them, right? And we know that in today's world, what is happening to us is that the world is trying to divide us all into groups. Is it not? Do you not feel like this is happening every day? That you're upset about something? That they try to rile you up about something else and get you upset about something else going on? More bad news. And they try to divide us into groups. Right? And so what does this author come to the conclusion of? I want to read it to you based on his insight to the movie and perception of the Joker. He says this, if I'm fighting evil, I cannot be good, because then I would surely lose. Sadly, I must become more evil than evil. Paraphrasing Friedrich Nietzsche, we might say that whoever fights monsters will surely become a monster. So the worldview that's being presented here is this, that in order to overcome evil, the only answer we have is to become more evil than the evil we see. Our only hope is becoming so torn up and angry that we have to stop the evil that we see. And how can we do it? Only through acts of evil. We must destroy things, even if it means destroy people. We must take hold of things and rebel and riot and burn things down, right? Is this not the worldview that we see playing out? But what is the Christian ethic on this? The Christian ethic says this in Romans 12, do not be overcome by evil. Romans 12, verse 21, instead, overcome evil with good. Well, where is that source of good? Where do we look for it in that? Well, this is the foolishness of what Paul's talking about here. He's saying for people outside of the Christian worldview, they're going to think you're crazy. They're going to think your answer, the response to evil in your life is complete foolishness. But he says it is Christ's crucifixion alone. In chapter 1, verse 22 of 24 of Corinthians, he says, Jews demand signs and Greeks look for wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. And so we are called by the Lord to Christ, the wisdom. That in everything we do, in every situation we're asked to respond to, we say, what would Christ do? Or WWJD, what would Jesus do? He's lived. He's been tempted in every way like we are. And yet he was perfect. He never once gave in to temptation, but instead, he always was obedient to the Father. And we see it most clearly in the cross, that even if it cost us, even if it cost us dearly, even our lives, we are called not to be overcome by evil, but instead to overcome evil with good. And this is why in verses 24, for example, it says, but to those whom God has called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. And so here's the picture. He says that Jews, to the Jews, the cross is a stumbling block. I'm going to tell you why. In Galatians 3 and in Deuteronomy, it says, cursed is anyone who hangs on a cross or hangs on a tree. It's a stumbling block because they see Jesus as accursed. They see him as one that could not be the Messiah that's prophesied in the Old Testament. For surely he was going to come in all his power, in all his royalty. He was going to come as a king. So the paradigm doesn't match what I had planned in my mind. When I see little baby Jesus in the manger, it doesn't match the royal king that was going to come in a palace. When I see Jesus and the Messiah that was anointed and he was going to establish a freedom from the Romans and he was going to establish a powerful empire that would never be defeated, it can't be found in the cross where he gives up his life. It's a stumbling block. How can he set up an empire if he's not on the earth? Even the disciples were confused when they say, Jesus, can we sit on your right and left side when you come to reign in your power? And Jesus says, you don't even know what you're asking. Can you drink of the cup of the wrath, of the persecution that you will have to endure? And then it's also this, it's foolishness to the Gentiles. In their worldview, they had this plethora of gods, right? Polytheistic. And in them, they'd say, how can a God not defeat his enemies? Jesus didn't defeat his enemies. He instead was subjected to him. They handcuffed him. They nailed him to a cross. They took him captive. How can he be the most powerful God? How can he be the King of kings and the Lord of lords, as you, Paul, say? How can this happen? This is foolishness that you would want us to look at a God whose father killed him and crushed him, and that's where we place our salvation? What kind of father would do that? What kind of savior is this? That he's not even that powerful. He can't even subdue the enemies and the evil that's present around him. But instead, he becomes subjected to him, and this becomes the faithful fruition of God. I want you to know fruition is just that plan of God. It's the unfolding of what we see in Philippians 1:6, right? He who began a good work in you will carry it on to what? Completion. It's the completion of his plan. This is what we see. We see it in James 1-4. It says, James 1:1-4, where it says, consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds. For in it, you know that God is working his plan in you to develop perseverance and perseverance character. And he's working his plan of fruition in you. Psalm 14, for example, says, it is a fool who says there is no God, right? But instead, the plan of God is that he wants to be known and he has revealed himself through Jesus. In John 14 and John 6, we see the revelation of God's plan coming together. In Revelation chapter 20, in fact, it says that there will be a people around his throne, the saints who have been beheaded because of his name, and they will lead us in the worship around his throne. So even the beheading of Christians, it should not throw us off. It should not discourage us, because we knew that that was coming, because it was already prophesied in the Word of God, right? And so we see all of this. It's the plan of God coming together, and perhaps best seen in Acts chapter 2. When Peter preaches the sermon at Pentecost, he says, "Fellow Israelites, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth was a man accredited by God to you by miracles, wonders, and signs." Do you hear? He's telling the Jewish people, God, Jesus did plenty of signs if you were looking for signs. And they all pointed to the fact that he was fully God, that he was the full deity of the Lord, that he was the Messiah. They pointed to his authority and his power, which God did among you through him, as you yourselves know. This man was handed over to you by God's, listen to this, deliberate plan and foreknowledge, the fruition of God. And you, with the help of wicked men, put him to death by nailing him to the cross. So now the Greeks are looking and saying, wait a second, we did evil? The Gentiles looking, the Romans, wait a second, you're putting that evil on us? We were doing good. We were wiping out a criminal. We were stomping out a movement of someone who was trying to overthrow the government. And he said, no. It was the fruition of God's plan. You nailed him to the tree. You're held responsible for this moment. You put him to death by nailing him to the cross. Verse 24, listen to this. This is it. This is it. This is the God above all other gods. This is the power. This is where many people look at it as if it's foolish, but no, this is our hope. It says this, but God raised him from the dead, freeing him from the agony of death, because it was impossible. Get that word. It was impossible for death to keep its hold on him. The enemy that has plagued every single human from Genesis 3 forward is death. We see it over and over and over again. And yet, the one thing we could never defeat, the one thing that we could never have any control over, yet here's a man who comes onto the scene and he calls out to death when he calls out to the grave of Lazarus and he says, come forth. He calls out to all the power of the world when he looks at the waves and he says, be still. He calls out to the moment of sickness and to those that are sick and depraved. And suddenly he looks at him and he says, be healed, be well. Your sins have been forgiven, right? He goes in and he sees people that are struggling with these physical sufferings, and he meets their need. In fact, the leper, he doesn't withhold, he doesn't keep his social distance. Instead, he draws close and touches what many people would consider unclean, but for him, his cleanliness makes it so clean. And now in this moment, it was impossible. It was impossible for death to hold him. And see, this becomes the thing the Greeks have no answer to. The Jews, they just want more signs, but they miss the one right before them. That Jesus Christ, the resurrected Lord, has defeated the enemy. He's defeated sin. He's defeated death. He's defeated the grave. And compared to that strength, it was impossible to hold him. I'm reminded of a story, and I'll share this in closing, but D.L. Moody shares a story of a man that had a son, and he'd tell his son, he'd say, now son, he said, I'm not going to steer you into religion. I'm not going to try to influence you for Christ. I'm not going to try to stand in your way. I'm not going to try to lead you. I'm not going to make you go to church. I'm not going to make you study the Word. I'm not going to make any of these things happen in your life, because I want you to have the freedom. I want you to not be just polluted by my own preferences. Instead, I want you to make your own decision. And I want you to be able to guide through life in your own way and you to figure out the steps you should take. And so one day, years go by, the boy becomes a teenager and he falls down and breaks his arm. And when they go to the doctor's office, the doctor goes and he sets that arm in place. And out comes all these cursings. The young man, he starts to curse the doctor over and over again and call him everything in the book. And he just yells at him and screams at him. And this is many years ago before cursing wasn't seemed so bad, right? And so suddenly the doctor looks at the father and he says, "Ah." The father is embarrassed and ashamed and cannot believe how his son's acting. And the doctor looks at him and says, "I see you didn't want to influence your son in the ways of Christ." The dad puts his head down and he says, "That's right." And he says, "I see that you didn't want to force him and direct him on a path toward godliness and holiness." And the dad said, "That's right. We're going to let him make his own path." And the doctor stood back and he said, "But now we see that Satan had no problem preparing a path for him. Now we see that Satan had no objection to directing his mind as he thought it should go. And while you stood back, the enemy was working. I want you to know this, that the great news of the gospel is that it was impossible, impossible, impossible for death to hold him. And because of that great hope, there is hope for every person, every tribe, every nation, no matter what they have done, no matter how far they are from the Lord, there's a hope that remains. And it's found in the foolishness of preaching the cross, found in the foolishness of the gospel of Jesus, as still to this day a stumbling block for those that are demanding of signs. It's still that foolishness for those who think they have it all figured out based on their great empiricism and their great research and all their great intellectual ideas, and they miss Jesus Christ on the cross. But the good news of the cross is also an invitation for you to keep sharing the good news. And know that some will meet the stumbling block. Some will consider it foolishness. But for those that are called, for those that are saved, it is the power of God and the wisdom of God. Let us never give up sharing about the hope that we have. Regardless of what we have one message to tell. It's the most powerful message in all the earth. Let's pray together. God, we love you. Father, we thank you now for your goodness, your grace, your power. Father, your sovereignty, Lord, that you are in control. And God, while some people may consider us foolish, while some people may consider the cross and the deity of Jesus to be a stumbling block, while some people may say, "How can God do that?" God, we pray you would remind us, for God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son, that whoever believes on him shall not perish but have everlasting life. So the good news of the gospel, it was impossible for death to hold Jesus. And because we are in Jesus, it's impossible for death to hold us. What a powerful truth we have. God, we ask you to bless this time of meditation and worship in your name. Amen. Would you stand together as we sing this song?